Hey brothers and sisters from Manifest Ministries, it is Nasasha. I am back. So this is going to be the second part to Puzzles to the Purpose Availability. If you haven't watched the first video, I highly recommend it. It was really, you know, filling. It was ministering to me, and I really hope it was ministering to you guys also. So I'm gonna go ahead and jump right into the video. Today I went to church and my pastor, he was preaching, and it was a really good word. And he basically was talking about, you know, basically being expanded. Sorry, my lights turned off. But he was basically talking about being expanded, not just physically, you know what I mean, like in finances and in your job and things like that. But he was also talking about being expanded spiritually. And you don't want anything to hinder you spiritually, whether it be the past, whether it be, you know, things that are happening now. You know, God is calling his church to be expanded. And certain things in this life will try to hinder you. Certain things in this life will cause us trials and tribulations that will try to hinder your mindset, try to hinder where God is taking you. And you know, it is up to us to make the decision, the decision to say, you know, God, I'm making myself available to you, Father God. You know, just show me what I must do, Father God. Move those things out of my life, God. I want your will in my life to be done. But he basically described three types of Christians. And he said the three types of Christians are museum keepers, settlers, and then pioneers. And, you know, we all were like, okay. So basically, he described the museum keeper Christians as basically, these are the type of people that live off the dust of the past. And basically, they are so focused on the good times in the past. They are so focused on the bad things that happened to them in the past that they are too afraid. They're too bound up with fear to even move towards the future. They're too bound up to even move to where God is calling them. And, you know, Jesus said you cannot put new wine into old wineskin. So a lot of things that happen to us, you know, whether they are things that hurt us, whether they are things that were good to us, you know, but somehow, some way, those things are not in our lives anymore. You know what I mean? God is saying that thing that was good to you, I'm going to give you something even better. And this just reminds me of that picture. I don't know. I'll put it in the video. But it's basically a picture, you know, of Jesus, and he has a big teddy bear behind him, and the little girl, you know, has a little teddy bear, and, you know, he's saying, do you trust me? And she's saying, but I love this Jesus. And he's saying, you know, but do you trust me? You know, God has something so much bigger for us on the other side. God has something so much bigger for us that he sees that we do not see, but it takes trust in him to trust him and say, yes, God, I trust you. I know that my ways are not your ways, Father God. Your thoughts are not my thoughts, Father God. You have something better than what I can see. If this thing is not in my life, that means that what you are bringing into my life is so much better than what was taken out of my life. And the pastor brought us to Exodus, you know, when, you know, God was basically taking his people out of Egypt, and you know, God called them to the edge of the Red Sea. And, you know, so God is calling them, God called them to this place where it seemed like there was no way to go. Our enemy is chasing us back here, but here's the sea, and we have women and children, and babies can't swim. How do we get past this? How do we get past this roadblock in our lives? And most of the roadblocks in our lives cannot be moved unless we have the provision of God. Most of the roadblocks in our lives cannot be removed unless we have the intervention of the Almighty God. And God is saying, I know this is a sea. I know it is miles and miles and miles long, but I am the God that is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that you ask or think. And God is saying, I am the one that can see past this sea, and past this sea is your destiny. That is beautiful. But then from their position, all they can see is miles of sea. all they can see is just the road that is that roadblock. But all they had to do was trust God. And when Abraham, when Moses, I gotta get my people right. When Moses took his staff and hit the water, that was having trust in God. That was having trust in God. Then God moved it, and then God made a way. A lot of times we try to do things. I'm still laughing about the Abraham thing. Sorry. A lot of times we do things. We try to do things in our own might, in our own way. A lot of times we know where God is taking us. We heard God, you know, we know we are God's sheep. We are Jesus' sheep. We know where he's taking us. We have taken heed to his voice. But it does not only take hearing, but you must also be doers of the word of God. That's what the word of God says. Do not just be hearers, but also doers. You must also let the word of God reflect your life. You say you trust God. You read that you must trust God, but do you actually trust him? You must exercise your faith. You must exercise, you know, your trust in him. And that's what God is wanting us to do. He wants us to, you know, exercise our faith. So basically that Red Sea was just an exercise. You know what I mean? You go to the gym to get stronger. You train. You know, we see these athletes to train and things like, we see these athletes train and they're training because they're going to go play, you know, in a game or whatever. Thank you, Lord, Father God. But they never would have had those abilities if they never trained for it. They would have been tired on the field. God is calling his church, you know what I mean, to go out and reach souls. God is calling our each and every single relationship that we have is a ministry. Whether you have children, whether you have a husband or a wife, whether you have friends. When God is living within you, your life itself is a ministry. Your relationship itself is a ministry. So it doesn't matter if you're not a pastor. It doesn't matter if you're not an evangelizer or whatever. Your life is still a ministry. You are still ministering to somebody. And that's why it is so important, because we are the ones that are reflecting God. The Bible says to be imitators of God. God is saying, I know these trials and tribulations are coming onto you. But do you trust me? These things are things that is going to be used to exercise your faith. And you will grow up and you will be strong so that when something else that, when something bigger comes, you are ready to take it head on. So don't be a museum keeper. Don't be a person that's too scared to move forward. You know, the people that you know, God's people that were, you know, taken captive by the Egyptians, you know, when they were slaves, they could have saw the sea and they could have been like, I'm not going. But they trusted God and they moved forward. But then it was like, once they got past the Red Sea and, you know, after some time went by, they were saying, you know, I want to go back to Egypt. You know what I mean? They began to ponder on the past and not ponder on what God is doing for them. And that left them basically, they basically lost their blessing because they were not willing to expand in their minds. God can only take you so far if you have an unwilling mind. So the next one I want to get into, the other type of Christian, is settlers. These are people that, you know, God basically took you out of a situation and he brought you to a really good place. But you got really comfortable. You settled. You settled. You got comfortable in the place that God has called you to be in. But Paul says, I press for the mark. I continuously press for the mark. So when God brings you to this mark, he's bringing you to another one. When God took his children out of Egypt, he brought them to that wilderness area, but that was not the promised land. You have So there is one mark, and there's another mark after that mark, and there's another mark after that mark. It is a continuous relationship with God. God is willing to continuously keep on elevating you. He wants to keep on elevating his children. He did not call us to settle. He wants us to be stirred up in our faith. He wants us to be stirred up in our ministry, whether if it's, you know, just your ministry, whether you're a friend, a brother, a sister. He wants us to continuously to be, you know, stirred up. So God is saying, do not settle. I know it's comfortable right now, but I know that today is a sweet day, but tomorrow is going to be even a sweeter day. I know the situation I've taken you to is really sweet, but where I'm taking you to from this is going to be even sweeter. He wants to keep elevating his children. He wants to keep expanding us. You know what I mean? And then the last one is basically pioneers. And this is what you want to strive to be. Basically, you know what I mean? Like, you are just available to God. And that's just the word of the day. That's the word of this whole sermon here. You are available to God. You are available to be used. You are available to be moved. You are available to keep on pressing towards the mark. You are available unto him. He is able to use you. You are dependable. And no, we are not perfect. And, you know, where our weaknesses are, God's strength is made perfect. But he wants a heart that is willing to him and that is willing to do his will continuously, not someone that's going to be stuck in the past, whether it was a good past or a bad past, not somebody that's going to be settled and comfortable in their little position. He wants someone that is continuously willing to move. So I really wanted to just share that with you guys. It was something that was really ministering to me today when I was at church, and it was really good. So that brings me to Matthew 8 verses 1 through 3. I'm going to go ahead and read it. So Matthew 8 verses 1 through 3, I'm going to read it for you guys. When he had come down from the mountain, great multitudes followed him. And behold, a leper came and worshipped him, saying, Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean. Then Jesus put out his hand and touching him, saying, I am willing, be cleansed. Immediately his leprosy was cleansed. So Matthew 8, 1 through 3 speaks of a man who was sick. He was sick with a disease that at that time was not treatable. There was no cure. Now, in this day and age, it is curable with a 6 to 12 month treatment. But at that time, that man basically, he had no hope. At that time, basically, because this was, you know, a disease that was not curable, he had no hope. The world had nothing to do with him. The world had nothing to offer him. He was most likely outcast because this disease, you know, it was contagious. But the beautiful thing is that he knew one person. He knew one person that had and has the power. He knew one person who freely gives to those. He knew one person that freely gives and freely gave with no questions asked. He knew the person who was and is able to heal any infirmity. And he made himself available to Jesus. Excuse me. So he came unto Jesus and he worshiped him. And he said, Lord, if you are willing, I know you can make me clean. That's having faith in God. That's not having faith in the world. Coming unto Jesus and worshiping him. When you worship, you are in a position of humbleness. Thank you, Lord. And he knew, and that's why he came to Jesus, because he knew Jesus was the one and is the one that is able to heal him no matter what it is. He had faith in the one and true doctor, the Almighty God, Jesus Christ. and he placed himself in a position of humbleness. He placed himself in a position to worship God, to worship Jesus. It's all about the kind of mindset you have. He said, God, if you are willing, Jesus said, I am willing, be cleansed. But how could he have been cleansed if he never made himself available to him? How could he ever, if his trust was never in God, this man would have died a leper. If this man never trusted in Jesus, if he never trusted in the power of God, he would have died a leper. He would have been settled in the position that he was in, and he would have died in his circumstances. And that's why it's a mindset. It's a wanting to want to be changed, to want to be renewed, to want to be different.
Sorry, guys, my battery died. But God is saying, I am willing. This man made himself available to God. So if God is willing to heal you, if God is willing to expand your life, why are you not willing? Why are you not making yourself available to him? Yes, we are children of God, but many of us will die in our stagnancy because we either don't move but stay there, or go back to where God has called us from. How can you ever obtain freedom if you never make yourself available to the one who gives freedom? How can you be risen up if you never died for those things? Sorry, if you never died to those things. How can you be risen up if you never died to those things? How can you be risen up if you never died to the sins that God has called you from? You know what I mean? Jesus says you must pick up your cross, bear your cross. We have died and we are risen back up with him again. Many people have a mindset of wanting God to perform, but not being available to be performed on. That's like going to a doctor and saying, hey, I'm sick, but not showing up on the operating table or not taking the prescribed medications. Now reading Ezekiel 36:26, it says, a new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you, and I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you, and cause you to walk in my statutes, and you shall keep my judgments and do them. So God is basically saying, I'm going to give you a new heart. I'm going to give you a new spirit. And the mindset, the ways that you had before, they won't even be satisfaction to you anymore. You won't even desire to think that way anymore. You won't even desire to do those things before, those things that used to make you happy or think that made you happy. I will show you true happiness. And Matthew 4:4 says, man shall not eat of bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. So only living day to day, you know what I mean? Not having the provision of God, living day to day not having the authority of God, that will not cut it. Jesus says you must not only live by bread, you must not only just live this life, but you should live this life also with the bread of God. You should crave the word of God. You should want to voraciously eat the word of God, continuously having a crave for it, because this is what your life is built on. And I've always said this, you know what I mean? Like, this world puts up a front with social media and, you know what I mean, just, you know, you see the rappers and the artists and the actors, and they put up this front, you know, and they're living their lives, and a lot of them are living a sinful life, And they make it seem like this life is filled with so much happiness. You have all these riches that this earth can provide. But if they're so happy, I know a lot of people might get mad at me for saying this, but if they're so happy, why is so many of them committing suicide? It's because that even though that it may be satisfaction to their flesh, sorry, for one moment, there's no satisfaction to the soul. There's no satis This world cannot satisfy your soul. This world cannot give you what God has already created, what God has already put in motion. And the enemy is trying to entice you and say, come eat of this fruit. Eat of this fruit. It's nice over here on this side. And then you end up losing your soul. The word of God says, what's the point of gaining the world and then you lose your soul? This world cannot satisfy your soul. This world cannot make you happy the way God makes you happy. This world cannot, bring you joy and peace. The word of God says, my peace surpasses all understanding. This world will provide you a perverted version of the gifts that God has already set forth. And this is why God did not place Adam in the land of gold or onyx. He placed Adam in the Garden of Eden. In the Garden of Eden was God's presence. He placed Adam in God's presence. He did not place him in the riches of the earth. He did not place him where, everything was a bountiful. And yes, those things were good, though. That's when, everything was still good. God just freshly created those things. But God is saying, I do not want your happiness to be rooted in what will soon pass away. He is a God that is here yesterday, today, and forevermore. He is a God that is able to see into the future. He's saying, I do not want you to be rooting your happiness in, the wisdom of the world. I do not want you to be rooting your happiness in the love that this world gives. My love is everlasting. My love existed before you were even existing. In God's presence, in God's provision is where it is safe. Things didn't start going wrong until Adam and Eve decided to do things on their own way. God is saying, wisdom and knowledge come forth from me. Trust in me to tell you the truth. See, Adam and Eve, when they, when they sinned and they went and they ate of the fruit, of knowledge of good and knowledge of evil. Basically, they were trusting the world's knowledge. They were trusting the world's wisdom. They weren't trusting that wisdom or knowledge to come from God. They wanted to obtain that knowledge themselves. They basically became proudful. They became, in a way, boastful. They were saying, okay, we can do this. We don't have to go to God for, to ask him why this and this and this. You know what I mean? We can do this on our own. And the prideful heart comes before a fall. Remember that. The prideful heart comes before a fall, and yes, they fell. And like I said, God is a God, is he's a generational God. And because what Adam and Eve did, it affected many generations. But what God did was he went to Abraham and he said, Abraham, this is the plan. And through Abraham, he allowed Jesus Christ to be born through his genealogy. And he created a new generation of true worshipers, a new generation of true believers. Through Christ Jesus, we are now a family that, now we are not basically dimmed by what Adam and Eve did. Now we are enlightened by what Jesus Christ has done. So God is saying, trust in me to tell you the truth. I am the way, the truth, and the life. You can go to the world and trust in the world and its ways, eating the fruit, or trust in me. Whatever your need is, God is willing. Many people want the end product, but they don't want the road that's traveling to that end product. They just want end product. They don't want to have to go through all that craziness. But Paul is saying, I continuously press towards the mark. Most people want to obtain the mark. They just don't want to press. There's a difference between Christians and non-believers. Through trials, Christians and non-believers may know the now, but Christians have an advantage to knowing the ending. When the leper came unto Jesus, Jesus didn't say, "Hold on," or "Give me a second, I'll be right back," or "I'll do it later." Jesus accepted his humbleness, listened unto his cry, and said, "I am willing." We serve an on-time, available God. God is saying, "I have always been willing, but now, behold my vessel, I am able to freely pour into you. I am continuously willing, but now that you have opened up and taken the top off of the jar of your heart, I am freely able to pour into it. We are the temple of the Most High God. But are you living with a closed jar mentality? I want you guys to ask yourselves that question. Am I living with a closed jar mentality? Meaning, this jar is closed. You know what I mean? God, I'll come into your presence. I'll get a little bit wet in your presence. You know what I mean? Like, you know, like the mist of your spirit or whatever. Like, I'll get a little misty dew, but is God pouring into you? Are you available? Are you allowing yourself to be opened up to God and saying, "Yes, God, pour into me"? Are you living with a closed jar mentality? If you pour water onto a closed top jar, the water flows all around the jar, getting the jar wet, but not filling up the jar to its full capacity. And it falls to the ground and is wasted. What use is that? What use is that? If you pour water in a jar, if you have a jar here and you want to fill it up with water, but then you just pour the water on top and then the water is wasted, you're not using the vessel to its full capacity. You don't pour water in a jar just to lick the water off the jar. You pour water in a jar to drink from that vessel. So what's the point of just pouring the water outside on the outside of the jar? Of course, the outside will be wet for some time. But what matters is that the water is inside the jar. That is where the water abounds. So many people are going to God when they need something, but not staying long enough to get filled up. Lose the pride and take your position as a vessel and allow our God to pour out freely to the church. Ephesians 4:30 says, "Do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God." And what I got from this right now is, do not put a limit on what God can do for you. Do not put a limit on his power. He is almighty. He is all powerful. He is able to do past what we can even think of. Do not put a limit on what God can do for others' lives, for other people's lives. Do not be a hindrance to yourself. Do not be a hindrance to other people's lives. Don't go back to the pit in which you were saved from. You know, there was Mary Magdalene, I think that's how you say her name. She was a woman that was, you know, possessed with a lot of spirits. You know, there was a people that were blind. There was the lame. There was a people that were tormented by spirits. There was the lepers. All these people Jesus saved. And not one of them went back and were like, "Oh, please, you know, come back inside of me and torment me again," or, "Oh, blindness, come back upon me," or, you know, or "Death, you know, deafness, come back upon me," or "Seizures, come back upon." No, the pit that Jesus took them out of, they did not turn back because they saw a new life towards them. They saw something to look forward to. The things that tormented them in the past, they did not want to go back to those things. But remember this, Jesus said, I come for those that need a doctor. The people that already know that they're healed, I don't come for those people. These people are the ones that came to Jesus and said, Jesus, like, I need you. I'm making myself available to you. Are you willing to help me? And all those people that came to him, he saved them. But the people with disbelief, you know, basically, like, woe to them, basically.
Mark 2:17. When Jesus heard it, he said to them, those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick, I did not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. And it's funny because all of us are sinners and all of us fall short. He's basically saying the people that think they are righteous in their own heart, the people that, you know, basically say, like, I'm better off without God, I don't need you. He came for people that knew they needed help. He came for people that knew that they were not right with God. And those people, they came onto him and he was willing. He was willing. And then we go to Matthew 11, and this is verses 20, I think, to 24. And Jesus is saying, basically, he's rebuking the city because most of his mighty works were done in this city, but these people still did not repent. So, you know, God can do many things in your life, but like I said, it's making yourself available. It's wanting him. So, in many people's lives, it's not that God can't do a miracle. It's because a lot of people have a disbelief and they don't want it. Are you willing? Are you willing to trust in God? Mary Magdalene, you know, the lepers, the blind people, the lame and the sick. When they came unto Jesus and they trusted him to save them, they didn't go back to their afflictions. They didn't go back. So why are we, when God has taken us from our situations, why are we going back to those things? It takes to renew your mind. Want better for yourself. Want what God has for you. And that's just a simple statement. Because, you know, sometimes, you know what I mean? Like, we know God has a will for us. You know, some people just don't know specifically what yet. And that just takes spending time with God and allowing him to reveal it to you. And for the people that do know their will, God's will for their lives, trust in him. Don't go back to where he's called you from. These people that Jesus healed, they continue to follow him. And the ones that he said, no, I need you to stay here, they basically were a ministry. They proclaimed of Jesus's goodness. They spread, you know, the kingdom's goodness. They spread the kingdom of God. We are temples of the Holy Spirit. Some people come to God to just get the outside surface wet. Just a little feel-good feeling here and there, just a band-aid here and there. But why not fully give him our afflictions, fully be available to him, and give him our heart's desires? Allow God to fill this temple up so that you may have a reservoir to dip into for power, strength, peace, joy, not just little droplets on the jar that you can only lick off. There's nothing wrong with looking back into the past and remembering all the good God has done. Because, you know, There's nothing wrong with allowing your testimony to minister to you. There's nothing wrong with letting the testimony of other people minister to you. But don't get so stuck looking back that you can't look forward and see what new things he is doing for you. Isaiah 43, verse 18. It says, "Do not remember the former things, nor consider the things of old. Behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall you not know it? I will even make a road in the wilderness and rivers in the desert." God here, he's not saying, "Shall you not know it?" because he isn't willing. God is always willing. The question is, are you not willing? Are you not willing because of disobedience? Are you not willing because of unbelief? Are you not willing because of distrust? Church, it's time we position ourselves to be placed. God says, "Out of our hearts shall flow rivers of living water," because he is the living water that pours into us. God is desiring for his church more than just a dip in the water, but a complete submerging in his spirit. God says, "I will pour my spirit out. Make yourselves available to him." How can God pour himself out into you if his temple is already filled with junk? If you are willing to let those things go, to let those things of old go, God is willing to pour his spirit into you. Because the more he fills you up with him, the more debris from life will begin to float to the top. And he is able to skim those things right off and cast them away from you. My love, it takes obedience. It takes trust. It takes faith. It takes availability. All right, guys, this was the second part. I really hope you guys enjoyed it. I'm sorry for my camera dying. but I really hope this, video ministered to you. It really minister to me. God is so good. Until next time, guys. Bye.